Each cell in the human body is wrapped in a membrane that separates the inner environment from the outer environment. And positively and negatively charged ions aren't equally distributed on both sides of the membrane. Fundamentally, it's these differences in concentrations and charge, as well as permeability across the membrane, that establishes the cell's resting membrane potential. Generally speaking, there's higher concentration of Na+, or sodium, Cl-, or chloride, and Ca2+, or calcium, on the outside of the cell, and a higher concentration of K+, or potassium, and A-, which is just what we write for negatively charged anions, on the inside of the cell. These anions include a variety of amino acids and proteins that are produced by the cell. Let's start with the sodium-potassium pump, which uses ATP to move 3 sodium ions out of the cell for every 2 potassium ions that it moves into the cell. This is like the workhorse of the cell, and it helps establish the concentration gradient for potassium and sodium. So let's focus on potassium, which has a concentration of 150 millimoles per liter on the inside of the cell, and about 5 millimoles per liter on the outside of the cell. With so much potassium within the cell relative to outside the cell, there'll be a fairly strong concentration gradient moving potassium ions out of the cell. Although these ions can't simply diffuse through the phospholipid bilayer membrane, it turns out that potassium can get across the membrane using potassium leak channels and inward rectifier channels that are scattered throughout the membrane. So using those channels, the concentration gradient pushes potassium out of the cell, and that potassium brings with it some positive charge and leaves behind some unpaired anions, which carry negative charge because they aren't able to go through the leak channels. Over time, as more potassium ions leave the cell, a negative charge builds up within the cell, and this starts to attract positively charged potassium ions back into the cell. And this is called the electrostatic gradient. This electrostatic gradient is established with the movement of relatively few ions, so it doesn't upset the overall concentration gradient that was already established. For potassium, the exact point when the potassium moving out of the cell due to the concentration gradient equals the potassium moving back into the cell due to the electrostatic gradient is called the equilibrium potential, or Nernst potential, for potassium. And it's about negative 92 millivolts. In other words, negative 92 millivolts is the electric potential for attracting potassium into the cell that's needed to balance the concentration gradient that's pushing potassium out of the cell. So the equilibrium potential of an ion is dependent on two things: the concentration gradient for that ion, and the cell being permeable to that ion. If we're only dealing with one single ion, then the equilibrium potential for the ion equals the resting membrane potential for the entire cell. In reality, though, there are multiple ions that have concentration gradients that are permeable across the cell membrane, each of which has its own equilibrium potential. Now, the formula that tells us the equilibrium potential for each ion is called the Nernst equation, and it's Vm for membrane equals 61.5 times the log of the concentration of the ion outside the cell divided by the concentration of the ion inside the cell for an ion with a single charge like sodium. And Vm equals 30.75 times the log of the concentration of the ion outside divided by the concentration of the ion inside for an ion with a double charge like calcium. For the four main ions that affect the cell's resting membrane potential, which are potassium, sodium, chloride, and calcium, the concentrations are 150 millimoles per liter, 10 millimoles per liter, 4 millimoles per liter, and less than 1 micromole per liter on the inside of the cell, and 5 millimoles per liter, 142 millimoles per liter, 103 millimoles per liter, and 5 millimoles per liter on the outside of the cell. Plugging those into the formula, we get equilibrium potentials of negative 92 millivolts, positive 67 millivolts, positive 86 millivolts, and positive 123 millivolts. One thing to note, though, is that since chloride ion's negative, the equilibrium potential actually gets flipped, so it's actually negative 86 millivolts. These all represent the charge in the cell needed to balance the movement of each of these ions based on the concentration gradients. And to make it clear, the concentration gradients themselves are potassium moving out, calcium moving in, sodium moving in, and chloride moving in. Since remember, there's low concentration of potassium outside the cell, but high concentration of calcium, sodium, and chloride outside the cell. And concentration gradients move from high concentration to low concentration. Alright, so the actual resting membrane potential of the cell will end up being somewhere in between all these individual membrane potentials, depending on how much of each of these ions is moving across the membrane at a given time. This differs depending on the cell that we're talking about, but in general, potassium makes up the biggest proportion of ions moving across the membrane, while the other three have way less moving across at any given time. Alright, so of all the ions moving across the cell membrane through the leak channels, let's say that 90% of them are potassium ions, whereas only 1% are calcium ions, 1% are sodium ions, and 8% are chloride ions. Now we can take these proportions and multiply them by the equilibrium potentials, and then add up the total to get the resting membrane potential of the cell. In this case, it works out to 90% of negative 90 millivolts, or negative 81 millivolts, plus 1% of 123 millivolts, or 1.23 millivolts, plus 1% of 67 millivolts, which is 0.67 millivolts, and plus 8% of negative 86 millivolts, which is negative 6.88 millivolts, which gives a grand total resting membrane potential of negative 86 millivolts. Now, this resting membrane potential is usually closest to whichever ion's the most permeable across the membrane, which in this case is potassium, right? But by changing the cell's permeability to ions by adding or removing ion channels, a cell can actually change its resting membrane potential. Okay, as a quick recap, an ion's equilibrium potential is the point where its concentration gradient equals its electrostatic gradient, and can be calculated using the Nernst equation. The cell's resting membrane potential is therefore a summation of each individual ion's equilibrium potential, depending on each ion's relative permeability. Thanks for watching. You can help support us by donating on Patreon, subscribing to our channel, or telling your friends about us on social media.